يا يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة وآتيناه الحكم صبيا
إذ قال الله يا عيسى إني متوفيك ورافعك إلي
محمد رسول الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سورة هود is a surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet in Mecca. It's a Mecca surah, except a verse or so that there is differences of opinions about it, whether it was revealed in Mecca or in Medina. But in general, the surah was revealed in Mecca. It's a surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam for the believers to be steadfast on the deen, warning for the disbelievers, giving glad tidings for the believers, and giving them all kinds of means of steadfastness, to be steadfast upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ways that the surah, those who were revealed in Mecca, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will talk about matters of aqidah, matters of belief, the hereafter, the Jannah versus the Hellfire, the ways of the disbelievers and how they ruin themselves when they turn against the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, against the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose the believers to be the ones to be obedient to Allah, to be steadfast upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the way they do that is by worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, by being steadfast on the deen of Islam and the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. It's a surah that stories of the nations before are mentioned more than one in a brief way for the purpose of bringing the hearts to have that fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that there is a way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that never fails. That means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He sent the messengers of Allah, He reveals to the messengers of Allah His revelation. People are split into two groups, the believers versus the disbelievers, and then the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that happened to the nations before, to warn the disbelievers at the time of the Prophet at all times. And even if individuals, they don't receive that punishment the way the nations before they received it, there is the moment of death where everybody has to face. And the moment of death for the disbelievers after the message has been made clear to them and they turned away from the truth is the real punishment for them. It's an everlasting punishment for them. So calling them, inviting them by the book of Allah, by the way of the Prophet ﷺ, to repent to Allah, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, to be obedient, to humble themselves to the Creator of the heavens and the earth, the one that is the owner of all things. And this is something that we will see throughout the surah, inshallah ta'ala. It's a surah that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, شَيِّبَتْنِي هُودٌ وَأَخَوَتُهَا, that the Prophet said, Hud gave me grey hair and the sisters of Hud, other surahs other than Hud. But he mentioned Hud specifically and other surahs. It was said in some of the narrations, it's surah Amma Yatasa'aloon, surah Idha Shamsu Kuwirat, surah Al-Mursalat, surah Al-Waqi'ah. So the like of these surahs gave the Prophet ﷺ grey hair. Why that's the case? As some said, it's because a verse or so in Surah Hud that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordering the Prophet ﷺ, فَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتْ, be steadfast the way you have been ordered, as Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said. And this is a heavy order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Creator of the heavens and the earth, ordering the Prophet ﷺ to be steadfast according to the orders of Allah. And the Prophet ﷺ did that in the perfect way. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the Prophet ﷺ the best of all mankind. And some said because of the subject of the surah. The surah talks about the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in punishing the nations, those who disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the believers, when they have the certainty in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to the Prophet ﷺ, as if they are seeing it with their own eyes, and that brings so much of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in their hearts, and therefore they would benefit from it and they would be steadfast on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the fear of Allah, and also with hoping for the rewards from Allah, and with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which are pillars that has to be established in the hearts of the believers. So let's start inshallah ta'ala with the beginning of the surah, Surah Hud. And of course the name of the surah refers to the Prophet of Allah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to his people, and how specifically the significance of that story, how it's mentioned in that particular surah, that basically serves the objective of the surah. This is something that we would learn inshallah ta'ala. So we'll go through inshallah ta'ala the first five verses of the surah, this episode, from the beginning to verse number five, Surah Hud. The first ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alif Lam Ra, Kitabun Uhkimat Ayatuhu Thumma Fussilat Min Ladun Hakimin Khabir, which means, Alif Lam Ra, this is a book whose verses are perfected and then presented in detail from one who is wise and acquainted. The surah, like other surahs, starts with letters. And these three letters, Alif, Lam, Ra. And it's to be recited as letters, not as a word. So these are letters, separate letters. And this is how it was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ. And this is how the Prophet ﷺ, it was recited to him by Jibreel alayhi salam, and therefore the Prophet ﷺ recited it to the people. What does it mean? What does Alif Lam Ra means? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And that's the most correct opinion among the ulama in the tafsir, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what it means. It's Alif Lam Ra. Does it have a meaning or it doesn't have a meaning? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. There's no clear text or anything from the revelation from Allah that says that it means this. But the ulama talked, as we mentioned that before in the previous surahs, that the ulama talked about some of the things, which is, of course, it's a good thing to mention with regards to these letters. One of which is that this Quran, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the miraculous words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged humanity to bring the like of one chapter of it, it's made from the same letters that they know very well. So with being from the same letters that they know, and they're not able to bring the like of it, that makes the miracle something that is really great. And that's in the context of challenging the people, that this is the same letters that you know, it's not a language that they don't understand, and even this is the fact, they're not able to bring the like of even one chapter of it. And that's why these surahs that starts with Alif Lam Mim, Alif Lam Ra, and the like of this, right after that the verses talks about the Quran. So the first thing that is mentioned there is about the book of Allah, the Quran, and some of the characteristics of the Quran, the book of guidance to all mankind, the book of guidance to each and every one of us, to get to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. The book, the words of Allah, the miraculous words of Allah, that the benefits from it and the miraculous meanings of it would never cease. This is the truth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So after saying Alif Lam Ra, then the verse says, Kitabun uhkimat ayatuhu thumma fussilat min ladun hakimin khabir. Kitabun, this is a book. It's a book, meaning the Quran, as it's mentioned also in the previous surah, Surah Yunus. So this is a book, meaning the Quran. The characteristics of this book is uhkimat ayatuhu thumma fussilat. Uhkimat ayatuhu, meaning its verses, has been perfected. Uhkimat, that means it's been perfected. It is not corrupted. It is not contradicting to one another. It's been perfected. And it's in such a way that it's not going to be abrogated like the previous books. The meaning of uhkimat, as the ulama also mentioned in the tafsir, unlike the previous books that was given to the Jews and the Christians, like the Torah and the Injil, they were abrogated by the books that came after it. But the Quran being the final message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the verses are perfected. There is no room for any abrogation or any change later, which the previous books, it was specific to specific people at specific times, rulings and the like of this, even though the matters of belief is the same. And then, since the Quran being the final message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no more change in the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's so universal that it fits perfectly any place at any time, no matter what the situation of the people is. So this is, the verses of it is such verses that perfectly from Allah سبحانه وتعالى with perfect rulings from Allah. أحكمت آياته ثم فصلت and then فصلت that means it, then it was given in details or presented in detail. And you would find this is the way of the Quran. Verses that gives the general comprehensive meaning with perfect meaning, and then the details of that would come in the different verses in the same surah or other surahs. And this is the ways of the Quran, so that people, they understand exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them. So the verses of the Quran, uhkimat, perfect. There's no corruption in it. There's no confusion in it. Nobody can change or alter anything in it. And then it's the details of it, so that nobody, the details are there, so that nobody would have an excuse to say, I didn't understand or I missed that one verse or the other. Imagine that the verse that talks about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship and the importance of that versus associating partners with Allah is one verse in the Quran. It would have been sufficient for the people, those who are seekers of the truth. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not make it just one verse in the Quran. But the entire Quran is about this. No matter what surah that a person recites, he would find clearly that it states clearly that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one worthy of worship. And then the details of how to go about with the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's throughout the Quran also in details. How to worship Allah, pillars of Al-Islam, pillars of Al-Iman, matters of wealth, charity, things are forbidden, things are permissible, all kinds of details. And all of that is مِنْ لَدُنْ حَكِيمٍ خَبِيرٍ from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that is the most wise, and he is the one that is acquainted of his slaves and his creation. He knows best what they need and what fits them perfectly and what's going to be the most just and the most merciful in rulings. And the human beings, they don't have that means, they don't have the capacity to know what is good for them because they are deficient. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them. So they need to refer to the creator of the heavens and the earth when it comes to what is best for them. He created them without taking their opinions. He created them in such a way that he subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what fits them the best, because he's the one that created them. So when he subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this message in the Quran to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so in the Quran what fits the human beings in the most perfect way to be righteous, to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he is Al-Hakim and he's Al-Khabir, the most wise, and his wisdom, nothing is the like of it. That means it's not, we do not compare the wisdom of the human beings to the wisdom of Allah. And the same thing with all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his names. And if people all have all kinds of wisdom, if all of the wisdom of all of the human being and the most wise among the human beings are brought together in one person, that is of course of no comparison to the wisdom of Allah, because the attributes of Allah, nothing is the like of it. That's why people would need to rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he is khabir, he is well acquainted, and al-khabir is more than just knowing. He's the all-knower subhanahu wa ta'ala, but knowing and more. That means he's well acquainted of his creation, what fits them perfectly, what is best for them, whether it's in rulings, in matters of belief, and even stories. That's why we always say that when the stories are mentioned in the Quran, what's mentioned in the surah is sufficient for the person. We don't need to get into details that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't mention. That means there's no benefit in it, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is well acquainted of what fits and what benefit best the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is how the surah starts, and it prepares the hearts for what comes afterwards, the details of what's going to be mentioned. And to submit oneself to the verses of the Quran, knowing that this is from the most wise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that is well acquainted of the human beings. And that's another benefit also to remember, that when a person wants to soften his heart, to purify his heart, or call others to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the best way to do that is through the message of the Quran, the way of the Quran. We might think that I know how to invite that person, how to call that person, how to soften his heart. Allah knows best. Allah knows best the hearts of the people and how to soften it, and that is through the words of Allah, the book of Allah, the Quran. We'll continue inshallah ta'ala after the break with more of the verses in the beginning of Surah Hud. So stay with us inshallah.
Muhammadur Rasulullah. يد رسول الله.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Welcome back, and we are still in the beginning of Surah Hud, and we just heard about the first verse in the Surah, and then after that the second verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says ألا تعبدوا إلا الله إنني لكم منه نذير وبشير, which means through a messenger saying, do not worship except Allah, indeed I am to you from him a warner and a bringer of good tidings. The verse says ألا تعبدوا إلا الله, do not worship anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the message of the Quran. This is what the Quran is all about, to worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we heard many times before, that the most exclusive statement when it's negating something, and then after that there is an exception, like la ilaha illallah, there is no one worthy of worship except Allah. So here alla ta'budu illallah is an explanation to what la ilaha illallah means, and that's part of the tafsil, that's part of the explanation of what's mentioned in general. The Quran explains to us the matters of faith and so on. So what is the meaning of la ilaha illallah? Alla ta'budu illallah. The meaning of it is, do not worship anyone except Allah. There is no ilah, there is no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alla ta'budu illallah. So the ibadah, any ibadah has to be only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the ibadah? What are the details of the ibadah? So this is in general, that you only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a person embraces Islam and he get to know that and believe in this first pillar of Islam, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, this is in general. What are the details? Read the Quran. Learn the deen of Allah. You will find the details of this. So any ibadah that you do as an act of worship is to be only done to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alla ta'budu illa Allah. Then it says, إِنَّنِي لَكُمْ مِنْهُ نَذِيرٌ وَبَشِيرٌ. Indeed, I am to you from him a warner and a bringer of good tidings. Who is the one here that is saying that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that through the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, basically this has been conveyed to him to convey to the people, to say to them that indeed I am لَكُمْ مِنْهُ, I am لَكُمْ to you مِنْهُ from him, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Two things, نَذِيرٌ وَبَشِيرٌ. I'm a warner. The Prophet ﷺ was a warner to the people. Wabashir, and a bringer of good tidings. And that basically comprises the message of the Prophet ﷺ, comprises the message of the Quran. When a person reads the Quran, he would find this clearly. Warnings and glad tidings. Good news for the believers. Bad news for those who disbelieve and they continue to be in that state of disbelief. And this is the way of the Quran. This is what the Prophet ﷺ did to the people. And this is the followers of the Prophet ﷺ. They should follow the same path. Not just warning and not just bringer of glad tidings, but both together. And that also fits perfectly, since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that is most acquainted and what he knows best what fits the human beings. Human beings, they function this way. What's best for the human beings is to have both, to have that balance between warning and glad tidings. Warning only might make a person give up and, you know, might not be even be steadfast on the truth, and especially when there are orders and so on. And giving glad tidings only might make a person relax the matter, commit sins, fall into the path of deviation, but both together. Warnings and glad tidings. And when we look at our life, even from the physical perspective, for a person to have a goodly or a healthy life or a good life, he has to work and act according to these two concepts. If people are just given good news and that's it, right? No warnings about anything, no warnings about severe weather coming their way, no warnings of diseases and pandemics, no warnings about anything, right? They might lose their life. They might be in so much harm because they're not warned of what's harmful coming their way. We as human beings, we function this way. We'll be able to deal with the warnings in the right way to protect ourselves, to take the means. And the same thing if a person just, his life is about warnings only, and there's no glad tidings, that person would not have much hope in this life. They would fall into depression. There's no goodness whatsoever. So physically in this life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us to be able to live in a good way when we have this balance between the warnings and the glad tidings and the good news. And this is how the message of the Prophet ﷺ. Warnings and glad tidings. So for those who wants to take the religion as just some nice things to talk about or glad tidings and everything will be fine and everybody will go to Jannah and will be among those who receive the everlasting bliss and goodness and so on, it doesn't work this way. That means people are cheating one another. They're hiding the truth. That are the most evil and the worst thing ever is awaiting for the disbelievers and the sinners, unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive the sinners in the hereafter. The hellfire, everlasting punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there's the everlasting enjoyment in the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the callers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is so evil for them to hide the truth from the people. When they would think, well, we don't want to disturb the people, we don't want them to feel bad or to feel threatened of what's going to happen in the hereafter, so let's just talk about some beautiful things, things that would make them feel nice and comfortable. We have to follow the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us if we are sincere towards the people. And as mentioned before, that example, that if people, they know something harmful is coming to the people and that person does not warn them, they will call him a betrayal. They would even later on would put him into trial, because he knew that there was harm coming their way and he did not warn them of it, right? So then the same thing when it comes to the messengers of Allah and the followers of the messengers of Allah, they know with certainty what's going to happen in the hereafter or the punishment of Allah, as the nations, the messengers were sent to the people and warned their people, there's destruction is going to happen to you, like Nuh alayhi salam said to his people and Prophet Salih and so on and so forth. And when people didn't listen and turned away from it, the punishment of Allah came to them. So, nadhirun wa bashir, both warner and giver of glad tidings. So, ordering them to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And then after that, to perfect their steadfastness upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is going to be mentioned directly later in the surah. The next verse, verse number 3, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَنِ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ يُمَتِّعْكُمْ مَتَاعًا حَسَنًا إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى وَيُؤْتِ كُلَّ ذِي فَضْلٍ فَضْلَهُ وَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا فَإِنِّي أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ عَذَابَ يَوْمٍ كَبِيرٍ. Which means, and saying, seek forgiveness of your Lord and repent to Him, and He will let you enjoy a good provision for a specified term and give every doer of favor his favor. But if you turn away, then indeed I fear for you the punishment of a great day. So this ayah, as we heard in the previous one, the order to worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that the Prophet ﷺ is a warner and a giver of glad tidings, and seek forgiveness from your Lord. What's the significance of mentioning or giving an order to seek forgiveness from the Lord? Seeking forgiveness, that means there are sins. That means it's something that is inevitable. Every single human being, they are bound to make mistakes and sins. They are sinners, not by default, meaning that they would fall into sins. Not that the person is born with a sin, like others believe, which is a false belief. Human beings are born free from anything. There is no baggage that they're born with. But they are human beings. Humans, meaning that they are deficient. They're weak when it comes to being perfect. There's no perfect human being except the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala perfected him. So if a person give the testimony of faith and embrace the truth and says there is no one worthy of worship except Allah, and that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final messenger of Allah, and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, establish the salah and give the zakah and fast the month of Ramadan and make hajj, stay away from haram and do the good deeds, MashaAllah, but there's still going to be weaknesses. The orders of Allah might not be done in the most perfect way, even though the heart has that steadfastness in it and the person is so eager to do what is perfect, but we fall into mistakes, we fall into sins. So how to make sure that we guarantee to complete and to perfect our iman, how to be a perfect human being according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, according to how He created us. Because many people, they think when they talk about religion, they think that religion wants to have, or what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from the people, to be something else other than being humans. That they think that for you to be a righteous person, that means you have to be like the angels. That means you're sinless, that you do not make any mistakes. No mistakes whatsoever, no sins whatsoever. That does not exist on the face of earth. It's very important for us to understand this is the nature of the human beings. Many of the disputes and relationships because of not understanding this concept. So when a wife, for example, expecting that her husband would never fall into a mistake, when a husband would expect that his wife would never have any weakness or deficiency, it does not exist on the face of earth. Or friends or things, or even a person of knowledge or students of knowledge or whatever. Everybody is bound to make mistakes. This is how the human beings. It's not to justify the sins and the mistakes, but the verse is calling us to be always perfecting our iman, perfecting our state of faith by doing what? By constantly seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By doing the best that a person can to be steadfast on the deen of Allah and always seeking forgiveness from Allah, this is how a person can guarantee to perfect his iman. This is what it means to be steadfast upon the deen of Allah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet ﷺ later on. It's mentioned here in some details, and later on the order will be فَاسْتَقِمْ كَمَا أُمِرْتَ. Be steadfast the way that you have been ordered. How to be steadfast? This is what the verses in the beginning of the surah is giving us, how to be steadfast. Worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. That means you would do the best you can to perfect the orders of Allah. And then constantly seeking forgiveness from Allah. Always repenting to Allah. ثُمْ وَأَنِ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ. استغفروا, that means seek forgiveness. You ask for forgiveness from your Lord. وَأَنِ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ. Your Lord, the one that forgives. The creator of the heavens and the earth. ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ. Then repent to Him. Repenting to Allah, that means always return to Allah. As if the sin takes a person away from Allah. So that means he needs to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the tawbah is more than just seeking forgiveness. A tawbah is to return, meaning to repent from the sin, to leave the sin, to regret the sin, to have the intentions that a person would not do it again. And when a person returns to Allah, what that means? He leaves the sin and he is steadfast upon what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from him. Whether it's something related to the sin or not. For example, if someone used to commit a sin, say for example drinking, whether it's intoxicant or whatever there is, or lying or backbiting. So he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from that sin. That means he left it, he regretted it, he has the strong intention that he would not commit it again, right? And he leaves the sin. This is only halfway of what the tawbah is all about. Repentance is to do all of this and then to adopt the religion of Islam. When a person returning to Allah as if he is reviving his covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, renewing it. That means that would show in his salah. He would perfect his prayers more because he repented to Allah. He would fix all of the deficiencies in his life. And this is how a person would repent to Allah and seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ. So if you do this, if you perfect your tawheed, your belief in Allah, that He's the only one worthy of worship, you're obedient to Allah, and then you're constantly seeking forgiveness from your Lord and repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all times, what happens? يُمَتِّعْكُمْ مَتَاعًا حَسَنًا إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى. He will let you enjoy a good provision for a specified term, which is this life. يُمَتِّعْكُمْ. المَتَاع is enjoyment, but it's a temporarily one. It's a temporary one. It's not an everlasting one. It's mata'. That means it's an enjoyment, but temporary. يُمَتِّعْكُمْ. Who's the one that is going to give you that enjoyment? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, you would not be able to enjoy anything in this life. This life is a life of enjoyment. Yes, it has lots of enjoyment in it, but it's not created for the enjoyment. The enjoyment in this life is temporary. That means it's a mean to what's everlasting. And that's how the hearts of the believers, they should see it. Therefore, they don't forbid the enjoyment of this life if it's halal. And they have no problem in, you know, the believers, they enjoy themselves in the halal way, in the permissible way. And they understand that this is only temporary. It's not going to be forever. So therefore, their hearts are attached to the hereafter and not to the worldly benefits of this life. وَيُؤْتِي. And what is the أَجَلْ مُسَمَّى? What is the limited or the specified term? It's the moment of death. If people are steadfast and obedient to Allah, they will have an enjoyment in this life, as we all see, till the moment of death. وَيُؤْتِي كُلَّ ذِي فَضْلٍ فَضْلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one, since He is the one that would give that enjoyment, and He also would give for every good doer, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him the, you know, good doer of favor. He would give him his favor. وَيُؤْتِ كُلَّ ذِي فَضْلِ. He would give for every person of fadl, every person of virtue, of favor, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him his fadl. That means his bounty, his favor. That means the reward is given from the same sort of deed that a person do. A person doing something, favors to others, he's doing righteous actions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would reward them accordingly. This is the reward to the believers. And then, on the other hand, وَإِن تَوَلَّوْا. If they turn away, they turn away from this, they turn away from the worship of Allah, they turn away from seeking forgiveness from Allah, if they turn away from repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what's going to happen to them? فَإِنِّي أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ عَذَابَ يَوْمٍ كَبِيرٍ. Then indeed I fear, فَإِنِّي أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ, I fear for you, عَذَابَ يَوْمٍ كَبِيرٍ, the punishment of a great day. The Prophet ﷺ is warning those who turn away. You see how the giving the glad tidings and warnings both are mentioned in the verse. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيُؤْتِ كُلَّ ذِي فَضْلٍ فَضْلَهُ, that Allah would give every doer of favor his favor. So this is the glad tidings. Your good deeds are not going to be wasted. You will be rewarded of it, not just even equal to what you did, but even more multiplication of the rewards, as we know the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ and the verses in the Quran. That al-hasana bi-ashri amtali, that good deed is multiplied by 10, that's the minimum requirement for the physical good deeds. And then it's multiplied to 700, to 700,000, and so on. But the sin is equal to only one sin. So وَإِن تَوَلَّوْا, if you turn away from this, I fear for you a punishment of a great day, warning them of the punishment in the hereafter. After that, inshallah ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives more of the meanings, that gives that steadfastness to the heart, but we'll do that right after the break, so stay with us, inshallah.
Muhammadur Rasulullah, Muhammadur Rasulullah.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah. Welcome back, and with verses from Surah Hud from the beginning, from 1 to 5. And we just heard verse number 3 and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling the people through the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and to seek forgiveness from Him and to repent to Him. These are the means of steadfastness and giving glad tidings, since the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a giver of glad tidings and a warner. So giving glad tidings to those who do righteous actions and warning those who turn away. And for us to reflect upon the word وَإِن تَوَلَّوْا, the word mentioned تَوَلَّوْا, turned away. If a person turned away from the worship of Allah, that means what? That means he's living a life of associating partners with Allah. If a person turns away from seeking forgiveness from Allah, if a person turns away from repenting to Allah, that means that person is living a sinful life. And what happened to such a person? فَإِنِّي أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ. The Prophet ﷺ, he is ordered to say to them, I fear for you a punishment of a great day, which is the day of judgment. And the real punishment is the punishment in the hereafter. And then reminding the people and warning them and giving the glad tidings to the believers to show the reality of this life. The next verse, verse number 4, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. To Allah is your return and He is over all things competent. إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ. Why should you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone? Because He's the only one worthy of worship. Why would you seek forgiveness from your Lord and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Because everybody shall return to Allah. That's how the verse started with, إِلَى اللَّهِ, to Allah. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مَرْجِعُكُمْ, your return. And مَرْجِعُكُمْ, not that you would, it's not mentioned as a verb, but it's mentioned as a noun that means it's something that is, it's going to be as stable as it sounds. Something that is an everlasting one, that you will return to Allah. Everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your return, that return, everybody will return. The return to Allah is not something that is going to happen and then goes away or temporary matter, but rather it's the state of the human beings. We are born, we are created to return, if it's correct to understand that concept, to have that sinking in into our hearts, that we are born, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us, so that we return to Allah. That means what? What's more steady? what's more of an everlasting thing is that state of return. This life that we live on the face of earth is not the everlasting one. This is not the norm of the life of the human being. The eternal life of the human being that everybody will return to Allah. So therefore, live this life on the face of earth with that concept, with that focus. Don't be fooled by the temporary life of this world, by the enjoyment of this life, knowingly that everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's, you know, the more we reflect upon it, even linguistically, that should give us that meaning in our heart. In Allahi marji'ukum, you will return and stay there. You're not going anywhere afterwards. You're going to be or to have an everlasting life with your Lord, returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will judge you, and not a human being. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge you. And He has two places for the people in the hereafter, the Jannah for the believers and the Hellfire for the disbelievers. So, إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. And He is over all things competent. He's the one that created you from nothing. No creator except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if that's very clear to those who see it and clearly believe in it, what is resurrection compared to the original creation of Allah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to do all things. He's able to resurrect you, to create you again after you die on the face of earth, to be resurrected. And He's the one that is able to create the heavens and the earth and so on. And it's present at all times. إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Matters of belief and effects in the heart that should be present as a result of this. As human beings, when we have something as a foundation, something that we build on, something that would lead to something else. So these matters of belief, if a person believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the only one worthy of worship, believing in the last day and so on, therefore they would act accordingly. Then the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the disbelievers and how they fool themselves and they fall into so much ignorant matters as a result of disbelieving in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next verse talks about this, verse number 5. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ يَثْنُونَ صُدُورَهُمْ لِيَسْتَخْفُوا مِنْ أَلَا حِينَ يَسْتَغْشُونَ ثِيَابَهُمْ يَعْلَمُ مَا يُسِرُّونَ وَمَا يُعْلِنُونَ إِنَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِذَاتِ الصُّدُورِ. Which means, unquestionably, the disbelievers turn away their breasts to hide themselves from Him. Unquestionably, even when they cover themselves in their clothing, Allah knows what they conceal and what they declare. Indeed, He is knowing of that within their breasts. So, the ayah says, أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ أَلَا. And this is what you see unquestionably, that the matter is in such a way that these disbelievers, يَثْنُونَ صُدُورَهُمْ. يَثْنُونَ صُدُورَهُمْ, that means they bend their breasts, they turn away, they hide themselves. لِيَسْتَخْفُوا مِنْهُ, to hide themselves from Him, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as one of the meanings of the verse. That means, as mentioned in the tafsir, the people of Quraysh, they used to hide themselves when they would take a shower, for example, out of the shyness from Allah. They would hide themselves. Or they would hide themselves when they having relations with their wives. They would not have it when usually their homes used to not have ceilings. So they would hide themselves out of shyness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's saying they're doing that to hide themselves from Allah, and referring to their sins. Or when they commit sins, they would do it in hiding, and they think that they are hiding it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that is well acquainted of what they do, the Al-Seer, the Unknower subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth. This is a foolish thing from the disbelievers to think this way or to believe that way. And also it means that they used to do that to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Whenever they see him, they would, you know, hide themselves from him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَا حِينَ يَسْتَغْشُونَ ثِيَابَهُمْ يَعْلَمُ مَا يُسِرُّونَ وَمَا يُعْلِنُونَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows when, you know, what they conceal and what they declare when they cover themselves in their clothing. So whether they are covered or not covered, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's in their hearts and what physically they do and what their speech is. Human beings, they might hear or see what they are physically seeing, and people can hide from one another, but nobody can hide from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And nobody can hide what's even in their hearts. Human beings, they do not know what's in the hearts of one another. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's in the hearts of the people. Who deserve to be guided because of what's in their hearts? Whose intentions and what matters of belief in the hearts or deeds done by the heart, sincerity and so on? Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. So whether they cover themselves or they don't cover themselves, this is part of the foolishness of the disbelievers when they do not know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes. Some of them, they would be in their worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the way they believe in Allah as if they are dealing with a human being, with a deficient human being. That's why you would find this alteration in their books in such a way that a person can hide from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth. Can a human being fool Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wal'ayadhu billah? Can a person do things or be in such a way as if he's dealing with a human being that is not aware or not seeing what he's doing and so on? And comparing this to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. What the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in the authentic hadith that إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَى صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَى أَجْسَامِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَى قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at your images or your physical appearance, but rather He looks at your hearts and your actions. So your hearts are looked at by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He sees what's in the hearts and what the actions of the people and what's sound and what's not sound and so on. So that brings the belief in the power of Allah, to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have the fear of Allah, to know that the deeds done in this life and how it's related to the hereafter, as it's mentioned, that a person will be rewarded or punished according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows in their hearts when their actions then becomes in place. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not punish just by the fact that He knows what's in the hearts of the people unless they would do their actions. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what they conceal and they would declare. Everything is known by Allah. So therefore, don't let the deception of others deceive you from the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching you. So for example, if people are praising someone, that person should not be deceived by the praise of people, because these people, they do not know what's in your heart. They only saw your physical actions, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows exactly what's in the hearts. So if someone is praised because of his prayer, because of his righteousness, Allah knows best what's in the hearts of the people, who's sincere and who's not. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يَعْلَمُ مَا يُسِرُّونَ وَمَا يُعْلِنُونَ. He knows what they conceal and what they declare. إِنَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِذَاتِ الصُّدُورِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-knower of what's in the breasts of the people, in their hearts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's in it, and it's hidden, and nobody knows that except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to their actions and who deserve, based on what's in their hearts, to be guided or not. Who's truthful from those who are not, who's sincere, who has the belief and certainty in the rewards from Allah, and so on and so forth. So this is how the verse is establishing the matters of belief, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise. And the surah shows us the power of Allah. The previous surah, Surah Yunus, shows the qadr of Allah and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise in His decree, and anything is decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Hud, it shows us the wisdom of Allah and the power of Allah, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most powerful and He knows what's in the hearts of the people, and they should be warned against what's in their hearts. They need to purify their hearts from anything evil, from associating partners with Allah, from being attached to other than Allah, from sinning and disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And nobody can hide from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because everybody shall return to Allah, and nobody will escape the return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or run away to something else. Everybody is under the dominion of the heavens and the earth, and everybody is under the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is ala kulli shay'in qadir, over all things competent subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as you see these verses as an introduction to what comes afterwards, to establish the belief and the steadfastness upon the deen of Allah as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered, not according to what we do, but rather according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. And we have in the Prophet ﷺ the perfect example, and that is through the Quran, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala perfected its verses and gave so much details, and that's from the most wise, the one that is well acquainted of the people, so that they are steadfast in the deen of Allah. The verses structured well, the foundation of al-Iman and the details of it, the entire religion is mentioned in these verses, really in such a general terms, that the only one worthy of worship is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with all what that implies, with matters of belief, with orders of Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered, things are permissible, things are haram, and things of that nature. And then to constantly seek forgiveness from Allah, to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the way of life of the believers. even at the end of all actions of acts of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would find that the way the Prophet is to seek forgiveness from Allah, not just after the sins, but after the salah. The first words that a person should say after making salam, after the fard salah, is to say astaghfirullah, 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 seeking forgiveness from Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised those who make istighfar at the last part of the night, wal mustaghfirina bil ashar, those who seek forgiveness from Allah at the last part of the night. Hazrat al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah, he said they prayed all night and then they would sit like sinners seeking forgiveness from Allah. Because no matter what we do with acts of worship, we need to seek forgiveness from Allah, because we cannot fulfill it in the most perfect way. We are human beings. And also, of course, very clearly, from sins and from disobeying Allah, so that the person would always perfect his iman and perfect his tawheed. And this is what steadfastness and what it means. Steadfastness is to be among those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, that a person is really steadfast upon the truth, but with repentance, with seeking forgiveness from Allah. So there is nothing on the face of earth should ever turn the person away from repentance. And that's a principle in our religion, so that nobody is to be deceived by the plots of shaitan. Shaitan will come to the person and say to him, you're a sinner, you did so much evil in your life, there's no way that your repentance will be accepted by Allah. So he would make the people not repent to Allah. That's why many of those who fall into sins, they don't repent, because it's the plots of shaitan. When we read these verses of the Quran, there's no exception. Every single human being, they should always repent to Allah. Upon the tawheed, to be a Muslim and to constantly repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what steadfastness is all about. And this is what we need to benefit from these verses and the coming verses, inshaAllah ta'ala. So till next time, and with more verses of Surah Hud, I leave you with the protection of Allah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
إلا الذين تابوا وأصلحوا وبينوا فأولئك أتوب عليهم وأنا التواب الرحيم.
فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون.
يا زكريا نبشرك بغلام.
يا أيها النبي إنا أرسلناك شاهداً.